I am Dr. Mary Schubauer Berrigan, the head of the Monographs Program at the International Agency for Research on Cancer of the World Health Organization, abbreviated IARC-WHO. An IARC Monographs working group of 30 experts from 11 countries met in Lyon to finalize their evaluation of the carcinogenicity of perfluorooctanoic acid, or PFOA, and perfluorooctane sulfonic acid, or PFOS. These experts, who were all free from conflicts of interest, reviewed all publicly available data according to the strict scientific procedures described in the preamble to the IARC monographs. It is important to note that this was a hazard identification and not a risk assessment. A hazard identification aims to identify the specific properties of the agent and its potential to cause harm, that is, the potential of an agent to cause cancer. The IARC classification reflects the strength of the scientific evidence as to whether an agent can cause cancer in humans, but it does not reflect the risk of developing cancer at a given exposure level or type of exposure. For example, an IARC classification cannot tell us what a safe level of exposure would be in the workplace or in food or water. The working group classified PFOA as carcinogenic to humans, group 1, and PFOS as possibly carcinogenic to humans, group 2B. The group 1 evaluation for PFOA was based on sufficient evidence for cancer in experimental animals and strong mechanistic evidence in exposed humans, supported by strong mechanistic evidence in experimental systems. There was also limited evidence for cancer in humans, for renal cell carcinoma, which is the main form of kidney cancer, and for testicular cancer. The group 2B evaluation for PFOS was based on strong mechanistic evidence in exposed humans and in experimental systems. There was also limited evidence for cancer in experimental animals, and the evidence regarding cancer in humans was inadequate. The working group concluded that for PFOA, there was sufficient evidence for cancer in experimental animals based on studies in mice and rats. There was also strong mechanistic evidence that PFOA exhibits key characteristics of carcinogens. These key characteristics are specifically the induction of epigenetic alterations and immunosuppression in exposed humans and experimental systems, and of oxidative stress, receptor-mediated effects, and the alteration of cell proliferation, cell death, or nutrient supply in experimental systems. For PFOS, the same patterns of mechanistic evidence were seen in both exposed humans and in experimental systems as for PFOA. For PFOA, the limited evidence for renal cell carcinoma and testicular cancer in humans comes from multiple studies of workers and from people living near polluted areas and also low-exposed areas in the USA and Europe. Some, but not all, of these studies showed a positive association with PFOA exposure for these two cancer sites. The working group concluded that chance, bias, and confounding could not be ruled out with reasonable confidence, and thus concluded that the evidence was limited. A summary of the evaluation results, together with a short rationale, has been published online in The Lancet Oncology. The complete evaluation will be published in Volume 135 of the IARC Monographs in the coming months.
Hello, my name is Roland Wedekind. I'm a scientist within the Monographs program, and I'm also the responsible officer for the Monographs meeting 135. PFOA and PFOS have been the most widely used chemicals in a large group of fluorinated compounds called per- and polyfluoroalkyl substances, or PFAS. PFOA has been used extensively in the manufacture of fluoropolymers, for example, for textiles and non-stick surfaces. PFOA and PFOS have been used in various applications, including Class B firefighting foams, building materials, anti-foaming agents, pesticides, inks, dyes, ski waxes, and surface coatings for stain, oil, and water resistance on household products, carpets, textiles, and food packaging. PFOS has also been used in different industrial processes, such as electroplating. Depending on the country, their use has been declining or has been completely phased out in the last decades, owing to agreements or regulations such as the Stockholm Convention. However, exposure continues via products made before the phase-out and via the environment owing to the extreme persistence of these chemicals. PFOA and PFOS occur globally in the environment, but levels vary greatly due to different pollution sources. Workers have some of the highest exposures to PFOA and PFOS, with inhalation as the main exposure route and potentially via dermal absorption and dust ingestion. The highest exposures have been measured in fluorochemical manufacturing workers. The general population is mainly exposed to PFOA and PFOS via diet and drinking water and potentially via consumer products. In communities near polluted sites, the general population is mainly exposed via drinking water. PFOA and PFOS are detected in blood samples in populations studied worldwide, and median levels are up to 100-fold higher in communities near polluted sites compared to communities without known pollution sources. Some continuing exposure may also originate from precursors, which are other PFAS that transform into PFOA or PFOS in the environment or the body.
I'm Dr. Federica Madia, a senior toxicologist within the IARC monograph programs. Numerous studies investigating epigenetic alteration in exposed humans to PFOA and PFOS were from cohorts with low-level exposure reflective of the general population. Many of these studies were prospective birth cohorts, which evaluated the relationship between maternal in utero exposure and epigenetic alteration in the neonates. This means that the agents can alter the final expression of specific target genes, that is, those associated with carcinogenesis. One study, for example, showed persistence of PFOA-associated specific modification between birth and adolescence. The findings are for us of great importance as they indicated epigenetic effects such as response to chemical exposure during critical time periods of development. And these effects may have long-term health consequences like human cancer susceptibility on offsprings. The working group noted that the experimental data corroborate the evidence observed in exposed humans. Specifically, in vivo and in vitro studies using rodents and human and rodent-derived cells. In exposed humans, PFOS and PFOA have been found to be associated with augmentation of lower respiratory tract infections and diarrhea, and reduced response to vaccination in children in several environmental studies conducted in different countries. Association of the reduced response to vaccination to influenza, for example, have also been recently evidenced in adults for PFOA and in maternal cohort for SARS-CoV-2. Importantly, these observations were supported by PFOA and PFOS affecting the responses of primary human immune cells, like proliferation or cytokine production. Moreover, evidence of immunosuppression has been also reported in several animal experiments following exposure to PFOS and PFOA, mainly affecting the T cells dependent antibody response.